मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट, केआईटी कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग कोल्हापुर. ही हैज़ मोर दैन 35 ईयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस इन टीचिंग एज वेल एज इंडस्ट्री, एंड ही इज़ गोइंग टू डिलीवर सेशन ऑन मॉडर्न मटेरियल्स एंड मैन्युफैक्चरिंग प्रोसेस. सो विदाउट वेस्टिंग मच टाइम आई जस्ट हैंड ओवर दिस सेशन टू प्रोफेसर एस एस मानी. सो प्लीज सर, यू कैन कंटिन्यू. हेलो सर, योर वॉइस इज नॉट ऑडिबल.
नाउ एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस यस यस
यस यस. ओके, आई थिंक आई एम डन नाउ. ओके, एम आई ऑडिबल अगेन? हेलो.
यस 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 सर, यू आर ऑडिबल.
वेल, थैंक यू वेरी मच गाडगे सर एंड द होल ऑफ आरआईटी टीम एज वेल एज ऑल द ऑडियंस हु आर प्रेजेंट फॉर दिस वेबिनार. I'm indeed honored for having given this particular opportunity by RIT and their co-host SVR Infotech in presenting this topic on modern materials and manufacturing processes under AIC-sponsored Atal Academy. So I'll be covering modern materials and manufacturing processes. It's an enviable task because I think you all can understand that to cover materials and manufacturing processes in 1.5 hours is going to be a very, very stupendous job. But anyway, I think I will share some of my thoughts and a few of my presentation slides with all the audience. I will not be able to cover everything at all, but let us see some trends, some future trends and whatever have been the developments as far as materials and manufacturing processes are concerned. So with your you can say permission, I will start the presentation. So the agenda for my presentation is initially I will have a small introduction as far as materials are concerned, and then we'll see some slides on advances in engineering materials, and then go on to some advances in manufacturing processes. As I said, it is difficult to cover all the materials and all the manufacturing processes, but we will see some of the materials and some of the manufacturing processes, okay, as I have listed down here. And lastly, we will just touch upon what are the various materials that are used in building of robots, because this FDP is mainly focused on robots. Okay, so let me start and begin with the introduction. You see, what I have shown here in the first slide is the historic evolution of materials before Christ and after the Christ. Okay, so what we can see here is the whole evolution of mankind. Okay. The way the mankind has evolved itself can be very, very easily associated with the kind of materials that were used during the prehistoric and historic days. So we started with the Stone Age, meaning the main material that was used for different applications were stones, as well as wood and bones, for example. Then we developed some we made some developments as far as metallic materials were concerned. Gold, silver, copper, and tin were some of the first materials that were we can say discovered and used for various applications. Then came a period wherein the first alloy, that is glass, was bronze was used, and that's why that period is called as Bronze Age. And then we discovered iron, and then glass, paper, and other materials that were discovered, and subsequent period is identified as Iron Age, because iron was the major material that was discovered. And then came the Industrial Revolution and the discovery of aluminium as a major you can say engineering material, and then on various other developments took place. So very, very evidently, the evolution of mankind is associated with the kind of materials that were used in different periods. Let me go to the next slide. So again, a similar kind of slide here, and it tells us as to how over a period of you can say more than 10,000 years, roughly around 12,000 years, starting from 10,000 BC, we had started using different materials. So even metallic materials like gold, copper, polymers and elastomers, which were basically wood, skin and fibers, composites by the way of straw, bricks, etc., and ceramics by the way of pottery, glass, etc., etc., cement, etc. They were the earlier used material. Subsequently, there was a huge reduction in the kind of the materials that were used by mankind, which tells us as to the kind of developments that happened, okay, how the mankind developed themselves. And then again, there is increased in the amount of materials over a period of time. And the present day materials include the newly developed ceramics, composites, plastics and polymers, and newly developed metals, which include not only ferrous alloys, but non-ferrous alloys. And different kinds of alloy steels, super alloys, titanium, zirconium alloys, etc., etc. So this you can say is the evolution and substitution of different materials over a period of time. Let me go to the next slide. Let us try to define material science and engineering. Now, material science is basic knowledge about the internal structure, properties, and how materials are processed. Okay. By using different processing, you can say, methods. Whereas materials engineering is fundamental knowledge applied to materials in order to transform them into useful product required by the society. Okay, so these two definitions are very important, because what we see is the advent of material science and engineering has led to discovery of new materials. So whatever the new materials which I will be discussing in short have been because of the advent of material science and engineering. Now, these newly discovered engineering materials find major applications in industry. And further, there is substantial advancement in these newly developed materials with respect to material properties. So what the newly developed materials have led to, they have led to materials which have better properties, as well as because of these materials, newly developed materials, newer and newer or modern manufacturing processes have been developed. Materials, as you all can understand, can be classified into metals and alloys. These are known as metallic materials, ceramics, then plastics and polymers, and composites, the major engineering materials. Of course, I have included semiconductors also as one of the major materials here. Okay. So what are the future technological demands? Now, this may appear more concerned with automobile applications, but nevertheless, let us try to understand what are the future technological demands. These are by the way of fuel efficiency, emission reduction, safety and durability, cost effectiveness, and innovative features. Features with respect to material properties, be it mechanical properties, be it physical properties, be it chemical properties, and all these different types of properties that are required. And these modern materials greatly contribute in achieving these technological demands for the future. Now, let us again take a look at how these engineering materials are classified. It's comprised of metals and alloys. We have plastics and polymers, and we have ceramics. So these are the basic engineering materials: metals, ceramics, and polymers. And a mix of any two of the three basic materials lead to composites. So composites could be a combination of metal and ceramics, metal and polymers, or polymers and ceramics. Now, focusing on some of these materials. Metallic materials can be classified into ferrous and non-ferrous alloys. Ferrous alloys comprise of steels and cast irons. And steels are plain carbon steels and alloy steels. Whereas cast irons, we have a variety of cast irons. And when it comes to non-ferrous alloys, we have aluminium-based, copper-based, magnesium, tin, zinc, lead, and nickel-based alloys. And when it comes to non-metallic materials, we can classify them also as organic and inorganic materials. Amongst organic, we have plastics, wood, paper, rubber, and leather. And inorganic materials, we have different types of minerals, cement, glass, ceramic, and graphites. Okay. Going further, so what are the trends, okay, as far as material selection is concerned? Now, the current trends by manufacturers is to strive to reduce the total mass of the components by developing new solutions. So mass, which means more weight, may greatly, you can say, reduce the effectiveness of use of engineering materials for different applications. And how do we reduce the mass? By using thin walled structures, okay, made up of alloys characterized with exceptional good mechanical properties. So in, earlier, for example, there is one material and we have now developed another new material. Now, what this new material helps us in is having components which are thin walled. So thinner the wall or the section thickness, you can say the lesser is the weight, and that's how that material becomes more, you can say, usable with respect to the mass in particular. Increasing content of components made up of lightweight materials, for example, non-ferrous alloys, wherein use of aluminium-based alloys and magnesium-based alloys, whose density is far lesser or lower than ferrous alloys, has led to weight reduction. And use of plastics, elastomers, and composites. So these are the trends as far as material selection is concerned. Going further, an overview of selection of materials for engineering components, if you take into consideration, materials used in modern engineering applications can be considered to be optimally accommodate the actual future demands. Normally, the change in material is only required if by that there is cost reduction or there is a change as far as demands are concerned. However, such changes at present or in near future are mainly concerned with ecological aspects, consumption reduction, weight reduction, low emission, and recycling. We should be able to reuse the same material, recycle the same material for use for the future. So these are the, you can say, overview of selection criteria of materials. Okay. Going further, the selection of materials is basically, it depends upon properties. Okay. So whether the material is able to satisfy the operating condition of the components, engineering component. The second most important criteria is cost. Any industry, for example, would like to reduce the cost of whatever the inputs. And the major input is, of course, cost, rather make it cheaper, to be made cheaper. And then we have environmental issues. You see, for example, presently there is a trend of not using plastics. Plastics are hazardous and they cause a lot of pollution. So these are some of the environmental issues because of which use of plastics and polymers has to be done very, very judiciously. Use of recyclable materials. Okay, as I said earlier, we should be able to reuse the material, recycle the material. That is one major, you can say, criteria as far as selection of materials is concerned. Weight reduction, particularly in case of auto applications, is one of the important criteria for selection of materials. Comfort and safety are the other important criteria in selecting materials. And lastly, what is very important is when we launch new materials, the designing and manufacturing of components made by new materials should have shorter lead time. Nowadays, every day there is a change in the model or whatever the engineering component, okay, model of a vehicle or an engineering component is concerned. And all these changes are required to be fulfilled by delivering the design and the manufacturing of the components in a very short period of time. And that's why shorter lead times are also a very, very important factor as far as selection of materials are concerned. Okay. Now, coming to design requirements of materials, these are some of the important design requirements. We have the first design requirement of material index. That is, it takes care of various material properties like strength, specific modulus, et cetera, merit index as to how the material is better than the other materials with respect to design adequacy, producibility, compatibility, reliability, cost effectiveness, etc. Structural index, which is stiffness, which is strength to weight ratio. Okay. Then we have shape factors, optimal shapes that can withstand different loads, mechanical efficient shapes that can be produced by using these materials, and specific properties like mechanical, physical, and chemical properties. So these are some of the important design requirements. A design engineer, for example, when he is designing a component, he looks into all these aspects of materials when he chooses a new material or replaces an older material by a new material. Okay. Now, coming to as to what are the advanced materials and their properties. Okay. So let us try to understand what are advanced materials. An advanced material can be said to be a material which has engineered properties created through the development of specified processes and synthesis technology. Okay. Generally, they are novel. That is, they have unique properties. So when we say advanced material, these advanced materials, they have novel or unique properties. They have improved properties over the replacements. Whatever was the earlier material with respect to, let us say, weight, that is density, strength, formability, how the material can be much easier transformed into raw material, from raw material into a product. And there could be some other productivity, that could be one of the other properties. Okay. So I have listed some of the unique properties, but there could be a few more unique properties or novel properties which advanced materials are supposed to have. Okay. Now, let us take some examples of current trends. Okay. Now, when it comes to, let us say, ferrous alloys, and we consider steels. So as compared to the conventional plain carbon steels, now we have developed a lot of you can say advanced steels, for example, trip steels, DP steels, high strength ceramics, low expansion or zero expansion alloys. These are some of the developments as far as steels and ferrous alloys are concerned, rather steels are concerned. And coming to cast irons, which is another type of ferrous alloy, the use of AGIN, that is ductile cast iron, has enhanced over a period of last 30-40 years. So earlier we were using conventional gray cast iron, but now we are using austenite compact processes, which can further enhance the properties of cast irons. And then coming to light weight alloys, we have aluminum. So we'll try to take them one by one. So coming to advanced materials, again, I've tried to reclassify them as light metals, which are either magnesium, aluminium, or titanium based. Then we have composites, carbon fiber, Kevlar, nanocomposites, metal laminates, etc. Then we have various types of ferrous alloys comprising of cast irons and steels, modern types of ferrous alloys. But then there are many other newly developed alloys. Okay. We have a big list of these newly developed. As I said, we will be touching upon a few of them. Okay. Now, why these new materials are finding place in manufacturing industry? Facing similar challenges. Now, what are these challenges? Improved fuel economy, for example, for vehicular. Reduced weight ratio, reduced emissions are not only pertaining to the use of the materials post-manufacturing, but during the process of manufacturing also. So which manufacturing process is required to process a material and how much of emission or pollution takes place during processing of that material also plays an important role. In other engineering applications too, the need body structure in which weight reductions play an important role. Current engineering component designs use standard materials which are nearing peak optimization. And now we have to go in for better and better engineering. Now, I have taken a list of certain materials, not all, but certain materials, and try to understand as to what are the benefits of these advanced materials. For example, we have subsequent to the use of aluminium as a light metal alloy, we are now seeing a marked increase in the use of magnesium and its alloys. Okay. Now, magnesium, if you see its advantages, is 22% of the weight of iron and 65% of the weight. Magnesium alloys are around 50% the strength of steels. They have around 50% of the strength of steels. That's stiffer than most plastics. Okay. However, one of the problems with magnesium based alloys is the corrosion problem. Okay. The present world market for magnesium is around 4,50,000 tons, and it is increasing by 5% every year. Okay. Now, let us see the next material and see its benefits. Titanium and its alloys. Titanium is as strong as steel and half the weight of steel. It's also having very good corrosion resistance. It has high melting point also. Is cyclic and depends mainly on the material is carbon fiber. It is lightweight, 75% lighter than steel, has high stiffness, that is Young's modulus. And then we have nano composites, okay, which are 98% improvement as far as stiffness is concerned, higher heat deformation temperature. It has the same impact strength as let us steels and improved fire resistance. So these are some of the novel, newly developed advanced materials. Now let us go back to the conventional materials and see something about these conventional materials. Okay. Now coming to steels. Steel has been a leader as far as engineering applications is concerned since 1920s. Okay. Even as of now, steel contributes to major chunk of engineering components. Now, conventional steels have the following advantages. Okay. They are less expensive. Okay. If you compare the cost of steel, for example, with aluminium, it is less expensive. They are stronger. They have good mechanical properties. They are sustainable. They can be recycled. You can, whatever the scrap that is generated, after the material gets damaged, you can recycle the steel. So that's one very important property. Its properties are modified by heat treatment. Now, one of the major reasons why steel is used to such a great extent is that it has got excellent heat treatability. Okay. Now, because of this important property, which is not so very evident in other engineering materials, we can modify the properties of steels. We can make them soft, malleable, and ductile when you want to process them. And subsequently, we can make them hard and strong when you want to use them as an engineering component. So this is one of the most important reasons why steel is one of the major engineering components. However, steels have the following disadvantages. One is high density, so low strength to weight ratio, and they are highly corrosive. Okay, so we have to take care of steel very carefully. We have to have different kinds of coatings, paints that are applied to steels. You can say we have to modify the steel by the way of aluminium to produce stainless steels, etc., etc. So this is what steel was. Okay, but then as I already mentioned, there have been a lot of developments as far as steels are concerned. Okay, we have advanced and high strength steels, advanced high strength steels, ultra high strength steels, etc., etc. And we also have various grades of stainless steels, which improves corrosion resistance. So these types of steels take care of the properties, and steels which are required to be corrosion resistant is done by the development of different types of stainless steel grades. Okay, in which we have one new type of stainless steel called as precipitation hardenable stainless steel. So not only the precipitation hardenable stainless steel is having good set of mechanical properties, but it also has good corrosion resistance. Okay, so these are the developments as far as steels are concerned. Okay, so this is a case study of how advancements have taken place in steels. Okay, from the initial mild steel, whose mechanical properties are evident here, we have the as well as the tensile strength of high strength low alloy steels as compared to the conventional mild steel, which has a tremendous improvement. Okay, so quite obviously, whatever the applications for which mild steels were used, you can use high strength low alloy steels made up of thinner cross section, okay, giving the same set of properties. Okay, and then of course we have more advanced types of steels. First generation AHSS, advanced high strength steels, ultra high strength steels, which include DP steels, trip steels. Second generation advanced high strength steels, ultra high strength steel includes austenized stainless steel, trip steel, and third generation AHSS and UHSS, which comprises again trip steel, which is aided with benite ferritic structured steel and TBF steel, and then nano steel. And then what we see is that these steels have better sets of mechanical properties, okay, and at the same time there is no compromise as far as their ductility is concerned. Okay, percentage elongation, which basically is a property which defines the ductility of the material, has not only stayed the same, but in some cases there is improved ductility in some of these first generation, second generation, and third generation advanced high strength and ultra high strength steels. So this is another slide which is self-explanatory, and I would be confessing to all the participants that I will not be going through or reading through all these different slides. Some of the slides, maybe you will be able to go through the slides and understand by yourself. Okay. And after steels, the second type of alloys, which is basically cast irons and other castable alloys, I put them together. So we have conventional cast irons, okay, as well as different types of aluminium and magnesium based alloys, and austenitic ductile steels and austenitic compacted graphite iron. Okay, these are all carbide grades. Okay, so if you compare the conventional gray compacted gray cast iron and ductile cast iron, and then again compare these are the various structures of conventional gray cast iron, compacted gray cast iron, and AGI. So we can see how huge change. Earlier gray cast iron, the tensile strength was as much as 250 MPa, but now the ductile cast iron can have strength as high as 50 MPa, three times increase in the tensile strength. And at the same time, percentage elongation, you can just see here, gray cast iron it cannot be elongated at all. It is very brittle, whereas ductile cast iron can have as much as 5% elongation. So ductile cast iron is, you can say, has properties equivalent to steel, but at the same time it is castable. So this is the importance of ductile cast iron or AGI. So one more slide which compares various types of ductile cast iron as well as you can say different types of cast iron, okay, and their application. So, the materials and manufacturing and applications. So what we see is coming to aluminium, these aluminium components can be extruded, they can be cast, and they can be made into steel, and they can be used for a variety of applications in let us say auto industries. The weight is very low, the cost is of course on the higher side, and safety, you can say, equivalent to the safety of earlier materials. Likewise, aluminium, weight is on the lower side, cost is, but we have better safety here. And then, as again, plastics and polymers, weight is on the lower side, cost slightly on the lower or on the upper side, depending upon the type of polymers, and we have equivalent safety factor there. And then we have sandwich materials, whose weight is on the lower side, cost is on the higher side, and equivalent safety factors. Okay. Now, this slide, of course, is more pertaining to auto industry, and what I have tried to compare here is gradual improvement in the amount of aluminium and aluminium-based alloys that have been used for different auto applications, starting from heat exchangers to wheels to cylinder blocks, hoods, and then ultimately to the doors and body in white. Okay, so if you compare the amount of aluminium that was used, so many pounds per vehicle, it was less than 100 pounds per vehicle in 1975. It has risen to roughly around 547 pounds per vehicle in the year, rather estimated to be 547 pounds per vehicle in the year 2025. These aluminium, you can say, alloys that can be used, that are used for automotive applications, help us in producing them by different kinds of processes, manufacturing process enhancement as far as part performance is concerned. We also have cast aluminium alloys. Earlier, the only material that was used for making castings was ferrous alloys, those which were used for automotive applications, for example, gray cast iron, etc. But aluminium has gradually replaced cast irons as far as the engineering, automotive applications, basically, particularly cylinder heads, cylinder blocks, etc. concerned. And now we have more and more of aluminium-based alloys which are used for such applications as cylinder blocks and cylinder heads in automotive industry, as well as in engines and pumps, etc. So this is another slide of aluminium pistons and how it is produced and the different processes that are required, helping us to reduce weight further. Okay. Now coming to polymers and its application. If you try to understand polymers, and if you it competes with other materials, it is basically by the way of weight savings There is design flexibility. There is part consolidation and ease of fabrication. So these are some of the important reasons why polymers are finding more and more use or applications in engineering components. So part could be trim panels, which can be made of polypropylene, impact absorbers, thermoplastic olefins, radio housing, ABS, and polybonates, etc., etc. So let us say metallic materials, now they are made up of different kinds of polymers. Okay, so this is again a list of various applications, okay, engineering applications. The material that is used, these are the polymer materials that are used for various engineering applications, and how they are processed, how they are manufactured. Most recent, most novel, and most unique types of materials. Let us try to define what is a composite. It's a homogeneous mixture created by synthetic characteristics. Now, what are the characteristics of composite materials? It is rigid with high strength to weight ratio. It has got good electrical resistance, resistance to chemical and weather, good stiffness, and good bend resistance. So these are the unique properties of composites, because of which now composites are finding more and more use and applications for engineering components. Okay, so you can see here how we have different types of polymer matrix. Okay, composites. We have, for example, carbon fiber polymer composite, glass fiber polymer composite, aramid fiber polymer composite, ceramic fiber polymer composites. So this is one example of composites, wherein the matrix is a polymer, and we have different types of reinforcements. And what are the advantages of these types of composites? Good resistance, corrosion resistance, stiffness, and ease of manufacturing. What are the drawbacks? All these materials, invariably, each material will have some drawback. High material and processing cost, okay. Poor fabrication properties, difficult to model over large lengths, and high cost of fillers, and difficult to repair. These are the drawbacks. Again, so as I told you that there could be different types of matrix materials. These matrix materials could be of thermosets, thermoplastics, and then we could have metallics and ceramics as also as the matrix material. And we can see what are these different types of composites made up of different matrix materials. And coming to fibers, the reinforcements. Earlier we started with carbon fibers, and we had glass fibers, aramid fibers, and now even ceramic fibers are available, which further enhance the properties of composites for better and better use for engineering applications. Okay, now another revisit to why we use composite material: better fuel efficiency when it comes to vehicular applications, more safety, crashworthiness, enhancing styling and part consolidation, and provides aerodynamic designs. So we can see some of the applications of these composite materials. Okay, and another slide here which I have taken into consideration different types of fibers and what they are called as, and what is the density, what is the modulus, and what is the strength modulus, and what are the applications. So please go through these slides and try to understand. One of the materials here is Kevlar, which is also used for you can say robots. So we'll come to that afterwards. Okay, now I'll skip through these slides. This is more pertaining to auto applications, and now come to advances in manufacturing are concerned. Okay, so we are almost 30-40 minutes in our presentation, and I have to cover some advanced manufacturing also. So let us see something about advances in manufacturing. Now before going to advances in manufacturing, let us try to understand as to how conventional manufacturing processes are classified. Now, conventional manufacturing processes are classified into primary shaping processes, which is wherein basically we melt the base material, wherein we have casting as one of the processes, melt extrusion, and then die casting. And then, of course, we have metal forming comprising of rolling, forging, extrusion, deep drawing, etc., etc., where the material is shaped by plastic deformation. We subject the material to stresses beyond yield strength and plastically deform the material. Here it is melting, here it is stretching the material to beyond yield strength. Then we have various machining processes, okay, cutting processes, metal cutting processes, including, for example, sawing, turning, drilling, milling, etc. Then we have different types of joining processes like welding, brazing, soldering, etc. Of course, we have riveting and string fitting also, mechanical assembly, which is a part of metal joining, wherein we use nuts and bolts, and then adhesive bonding, wherein we use industrial gums. The other manufacturing processes which are now being developed are plastic forming, powder metallurgy, additive manufacturing, okay, that is non-material remove. Listed down different types of metal treatment processes, which are also very important, which comprise of heat treatment, surface hardening, and surface treatment. Now, amongst all these different types of manufacturing processes, I will not be touching upon each and every advancement in each and every type of manufacturing process. There will be few processes which I will be focusing upon. For example, I will try to focus upon advances in casting, advances in machining, okay, and lastly, advances as far as metal treatment are concerned, wherein I will try to focus upon surface hardening and surface treatment, believing that you all are aware of different types of heat treatment processes and all the other types of manufacturing processes. Now, coming to advances in casting processes. Now, casting, as you all understand, is a very old manufacturing processes. There are evidences that casting process was used for making different non-engineering components, basically. For example, statues that we see in our temples even as of now, and different medals and medallions. Such casting processes have been used for centuries in India as well as the other countries like China. Now, the conventional casting process used sand as the casting material, and the sand that was used was manufacturing process for centuries. Now, this sand casting process suffers from various drawbacks. For example, the drawbacks are poor surface finish, poor dimensional accuracy, poor tolerances, poor quality, a lot of defects are there, high percentage of defects and scrap, and poor productivity. Now, the advances in casting processes have helped in overcoming most of these drawbacks. And what are these advances? The advances are in advances in process itself, advances in equipment and machinery use of casting simulation for better process design, and automation and mechanization in foundry industry. So if you see the modern day foundries, what you find is there is a lot of automation and mechanization in these foundries. And the present day foundries, as Kolhapur is a hub for foundry industry, I can tell you for sure that the earlier foundries, now they have shifted to new locations wherein they have started modern foundries. And these modern foundries, you will not believe, look like as if as good as clean as a machine shop. Okay, so much of advancement has occurred in casting industry. Now, to overcome the drawbacks that I have already mentioned, the sand casting technology has been modernized, and these new technologies that have come into existence, now we can see more chemically bond sand systems, okay, which are used for making mold sand cores. Use of metallic molds or permanent mold techniques like, for example, die casting, which comprises of pressure die casting, low pressure die casting, centrifugal casting, continuous casting. Metallic molds are used as compared to sand molds earlier. And use of special molding techniques like vacuum casting, squeeze casting, investment casting, etc. So I'll be touching upon a few of them. Okay. And this is another slide which shows the earlier conventional casting process and how the clay bond sand systems have been transformed into chemically bond sand systems, like use of oil sand, sodium silicate sand, cold box process, no bake molding, shell molding, etc. Then, of course, permanent molding processes like die casting, centrifugal casting, and continuous casting, and special casting techniques like wax or investment casting, vacuum sealed molding, and squeeze casting. So this is a comparative chart of some of the processes, not all the processes, wherein we have tried to understand as to in sand molding or pour making, which type of binder is used, and then what are the features of these sand casting, molding, and pour making processes. Please go through these slides. Now, this is one process which I have included here. Again, I will not be sharing the total content in the sense, I will not be speaking as far as total content is concerned. But if you go to the present day foundries, what you find is most of the cores particularly are made up of cold box process, which is a chemically bond sand system wherein the hardening takes place by passing amine gas. Okay. And these are the process, I have explained it here stepwise. So initially we have this particular core box, for example, which is split into two halves. And we have three magazines on top here, a sand magazine, a amine gas magazine, and an air magazine. So sand is inserted into the core box by pneumatic pressure. And once sand, which is pre-mixed with various chemicals, is inserted into the box, we bring in the second magazine, that is amine gas impinging, can say, magazine on top. So amine gas is impinged. And as soon as amine gas is impinged, this core becomes hard. So within a matter of seconds. So earlier, whatever the core making was done, it used to take a lot of time. But within minutes or seconds, you can say the core is made. And just to expel out excess of amine gas, we impinge air into the cores. So excess of amine gas goes off. And then you can just immediately, within seconds, take off the core by moving the movable, you can say, part of the core box. And just use the ejector system to take out the core. So you can see that this whole process takes place within minutes. Okay, so this is the kind of technology that has been developed in foundries to, you can say, produce better cores, better mechanical properties, better strength properties, and also better productivity. So these are the features of cold box process, the advantages that I have, a lot of advantages which we see as compared to the conventional sand casting process. And of course, they have certain disadvantages which you can go through. Okay. And these are the applications of cold box process. So these are the kind of developments that have taken place in foundry industry with respect to the kind of chemicals that are used, which can improve the properties as well as the quality and the productivity of the casting process by the whole. Okay. And of course, I will not go through again all these processes, but I'll be sharing all these contents with you so that you can go through all the different types of processes. So shell molding has been another development as far as casting industry is concerned, known as a hot box process, because the strength is developed by heating the sand. Okay, whatever the sand, which is pre-mixed with certain chemicals, in which once the sand is placed, you heat the metallic pattern or the core box to the level of 200 to 350. degree Celsius. Within, this is a comparison with conventional and shell molding molds or shell molds. Okay, the process itself, shell molding is carried out, is shown here. And at last, I have shared some advantages and limitations of shell molding. Okay, and these are the applications. And then coming to investment casting, as I mentioned, investment casting has been a process which was used more than 5,000 years ago in India, as well as in certain countries like China and even in African countries. But we lost this particular technology in between, which we can say was the dark period of human development is concerned. But now investment casting has re-arrived, and it is used for engineering applications. As I mentioned earlier, investment casting was used for making statues and medallions. Now investment casting is used for making engineering components. And one very unique application of investment casting is basically making you can say bone replacements. Okay, so if you have a fracture, for example, your bone is replaced by a metallic material, and these metallic materials, which are for example stainless steels and titanium based alloys, they are manufactured by using investment casting. Okay, so as mentioned, can help us making components near machine those components. So these are the steps in the process of investment casting. These are the figures indicating how investment casting is made. Basically, the pattern, as we say, is made up of wax, and this wax, subsequently, when it is coated with sand and other ceramic slurries, that wax is melted, and that hollow part where earlier wax was basically the mold cavity into which metal is poured, and we get the castings. Okay, so the earlier pattern and the early subsequent casting, these figures shows. So these are some of the advantages of investment casting and the limitations, and these are the applications of investment casting. Please go through all these different types of investment casting processes. Now I will not touch upon pressure die casting because it will be again a lengthy description, but I will come back to what is known as low pressure die casting. Okay, now see, pressure die casting has one major limitation. The limitation is, in pressure die casting we can't use sand cores. Okay, we can't use, if you insert a sand core in a metallic mold and then insert the metal at high pressure, the cores will break. Okay, so the limitation of pressure die casting was, the pressure die casting process was not possible. We could not possibly use it for producing complex castings. Okay, complex hollowed castings. So low pressure die casting is the new technology, wherein instead of hydraulic or mechanical force or pressure, this particular casting or mold cavity is filled by molten metal by using pneumatic pressure. Okay, so you pressurize the metal which is kept in a crucible by using air, and this air or pneumatic pressure will lift the molten metal into the mold cavity, which may comprise of sand cores, and you keep the pressure on till the casting solidifies, and then release the pressure after the casting has solidified. Separate these halves of the die and remove the casting. So the low pressure die casting is one of the advancements as far as metallic casting processes are concerned, and these are the advantages and applications of low pressure die casting. Now, having touched upon some of the advances as far as casting processes are concerned, my area of specialization, I basically am a metallurgist, and casting and metal forming are my domain, but I have tried to collect this particular information about advances in machining are concerned. Okay, now advances in machining, also called as AMP, advanced machining processes, has different nomenclatures. It's also called as non-traditional machining, non-conventional machining, modern machining, new machining processes, etc. But the new name, or the latest, or what it comprises of all put together, is advanced machining processes. Okay. Now, these advanced machining processes, they use either non-conventional cutting tools. So in machining, we require a cutting tool, is it not? So as against the cutting tools that are used in conventional machining, advanced machining uses non-conventional cutting tools, and it also uses energy in its direct form, like, for example, laser, electric discharge, electrochemical reaction, etc., for removal of the material. Okay. Now, why do we need advanced manufacturing processes? Okay. Now there have been a lot of developments as far as metals and alloys, plastics and composites, ceramics, etc. concerned. And advancements are getting more popular, and they have definite advantage over the conventional materials. Now, how do you machine these materials? Okay, so these materials are machined by using advanced machining processes. Okay, now as already mentioned, the present day demands or trends in industries, other aerospace, missile, automobile, nuclear reactor industries, etc. They require engineering materials having much superior properties. For example, ultra high strength, hardness, high temperature resistance, and generally speaking, these materials are difficult to machine. And how do you machine these problem materials? The solution is advanced machining processes. Okay. Now, what are the different types of advanced machining processes? I'm not going to go into the details of all. All these advanced abrasive jet machining, AGM, ultrasonic machining, USM, water jet, UJM. We also have advanced abrasive based nano finishing processes like abrasive flow machine finishing, chemo mechanical polishing, magneto abrasive finishing, magneto rheological finishing, magneto rheological abrasive flow finishing, etc. Then we have thermoelectric type advanced machining processes, which include electric discharge machining, EDM, wire EDM, etc., laser beam machining, LBM, electron beam machining, EBM, and plasma arc cutting. So these are thermoelectric type advanced machining processes. Then we also have chemical and electrochemical type advanced machining processes like electrochemical machining, and I just put this wrongly, electrochemical deburring, shaped tube electro machining, electro steam drilling, etc. And then we have certain miscellaneous processes. Okay, now again, coming back to why do we need advanced machining processes, there are limitations of conventional machining methods with respect to workpiece hardness, surface roughness. There are 3D parts, complex geometries, etc., increased workpiece properties, okay, and all these things need to be addressed, and that's why we require advanced machining processes. Okay, so these are again all put together in different slides which you can go through. Okay, now one of the major reasons as to why advanced manufacturing processes have come into picture is complex shapes. Okay, so you can see all these different types of complex shapes here. Okay, and to imagine that these shapes could be manufactured by using conventional machining processes was almost impossible. Small holes, nozzles, these complex shapes, etc. So we have to use, and then we have this particular turbine that is used in a helicopter, making of these micro holes, etc., which definitely is not possible by conventional machining operations, and we have to use advanced manufacturing processes. Okay. So we also have a classification based on different criteria. The first classification is based on the work material to be machined. Okay. So if, for example, we use ECM, EDM, or EBM, the material is required to be electrically conductive. Okay. Now, USM, AGM, and LBM are applicable to both electrically conductive and non-conductive materials. And non-magnetic materials can be processed by MAF and MRF, and thermal conductivity, reflectivity, etc. also play an important role, for example, in LBM. Okay. This is another slide telling us how the classification on the basis of electrical conductivity and non-conductivity of materials, classification on kind of energy used. So we use mechanical energy, thermoelectric energy, electrochemical or chemical energy, and these are the different types of processes that are used in all these different types of advanced manufacturing processes. Please go through. Then we have various micro machining methods. Traditional was micro turning, micro milling, micro drilling, micro grinding, etc. And advanced micro machining methods include micro AGM, micro USM, micro AWJM, etc., etc. And advanced thermoelectric processes include micro EDM, micro EBM, and all these different processes. So micro machining to manufacture components having very small holes, for example, is now a necessity, and for which we have micro machining methods. Okay. Some other micro and nano finishing types. Traditional micro and nano finishing types included grinding, lapping, and toning, whereas we have advanced micro and nano finishing operations which have been listed here. Okay. Now, lastly, I will come to this last part of my presentation as far as advanced manufacturing is concerned. And herein, after casting and machining, I have taken a different area altogether, that is surface treatment. You see, no engineering component is complete unless it is subjected to some kind of surface treatment. There could be a few engineering components which are not subjected to surface treatment. But then, if you go to an industry nowadays and try to find out how many of the components are subjected to any kind of surface treatment, you'll find that a majority of the engineering components are subjected to surface treatment. So these surface treatment processes can be classified into three types. Rather, it can be two types, but anyway, surface hardening, which comprises of flame hardening, induction hardening, laser hardening, etc. Chemical heat treatment processes called as case hardening, which comprises of carburizing, nitriding, cyaniding, and carbonitriding. And there are various types of surface treatments which comprises of phosphatizing, graphite coating, tin plating, hard anodizing, screen printing, molybdenum sulfide coating, and zinc plating. So we will try to touch upon some of them. I'll be going through some of the slides at a very fast rate. We've got not more than 15 minutes left as of now. Now, surface hardening. Let us try to understand why surface hardening is important. Some of the engineering components like crankshafts, camshaft, gears, etc., they require dual set of properties. Whereas the surface is required to be hard and wear resistant, the core is required to be tough and it can withstand impact, loads, shocks, and by that can be achieved by a single heat treatment, like for example annealing, normalizing, and hardening, or by using a single material. So that's why we have these heat treatment processes which will make the surface hard, keeping the core having properties wherein it can withstand impact, loads, shocks, and vibrations. So these can be classified into surface hardening or selective hardening or case hardening, which comprises of different types of chemical heat treatment processes. Okay. So surface hardening comprises of flame hardening, okay, wherein the material is heated at a very fast rate by using oxyacetylene and other types of flames and heat them and quench them at a fast rate so that the surface gets hardened and the pore remains tough. Okay, so I have listed the advantages and limitations of flame hardening. Likewise, induction hardening. Okay, and the drawbacks. And coming to chemical heat treatment, as against selective hardening in surface hardening processes, in chemical heat treatments, we change the chemical composition of the material only in the surface. Okay. For example, if you take mild steel cannot be hardened. Okay. So if you increase the percentage of carbon in the surface of the mild steel to an optimum level of 0.8% carbon, then that particular surface becomes hardenable. Whereas core will contain only 0.2% carbon, which makes the core tough. It can absorb shocks and vibrations. Whereas the surface, wherein you have increased the carbon percentage to roughly around 0.8, it can get hardened by martensitic transformation, that is heating and quenching. And we have a hard surface and a soft core, which is suitable for some of the engineering applications. Okay, so chemical heat treatment of steels are not only used for increasing the hardness, but they are used for increasing the hardenability, corrosion resistance, and heat resistance. Okay, so I have listed down all these different types of chemical heat treatments like carburizing, nitriding, cyaniding, and carbonitriding. Whereas in carburizing, only carbon is diffused; in nitriding, nitrogen is diffused. And in cyaniding and carbonitriding, both carbon and nitrogen are diffused. Okay, so these are the subtypes here, the process temperature, and what kind of raw material is used. Okay, that is mentioned here. Okay, so pack carburizing was the earliest of the carburizing processes. The advantages and disadvantages are mentioned here. Okay, and then coming to liquid carburizing, wherein most of the carburizing is done presently. They use these modern furnaces, which are you can say either electrically heated or they're heated by using different types of fuel gases, okay, liquid or gaseous gases. And by using such furnaces, we can carry out liquid carburizing, which has different advantages and limitations, which I have mentioned here. And the latest trend is to use gas carburizing, which gives the best result, wherein special types of furnaces are used, called as retort type of furnaces or sealed quench type of furnaces or continuous pusher type of furnaces. So this is an example of a batch type pit furnace, which is used for gas carburizing. All the features have been mentioned here. This is a conveyor furnace, wherein material is put, is inserted from one end. It goes through the initial heating, carburizing, and diffusion chambers, and subsequently it is dropped into a quench tank to make the surfaces harder. Okay, so this is gas carburizing and all the features, the advantages, limitations. Now, one thing about carburizing is which you all have to remember is carburizing is not the end of the process. After carburizing, we have to subject the surface to hardening process, and then only you can use them for subsequent heat treatment process, sorry, applications, engineering applications. So all these post carburizing processes that I have mentioned here, you can go through them. And nitriding is another very unique process. Okay, and it has a lot of advantages as compared to carburizing. The operating temperatures are lower. Okay, there is a volumetric expansion that occurs during nitriding, which leaves the parts with compressive state at the surface, increasing the fatigue strength. It has got better corrosion resistance. Okay, nitrites are non-metallic, and therefore there is resistance to galling and if they are used for bearing applications. Okay, and they have got very high hardness compared to carburizing. Okay, these are some of the disadvantages of nitriding. I'll not go through cyaniding and carbonitriding. You please go through all these slides. Okay, but I mentioned all the advantages, disadvantages, and limitations. Okay, and now we come to surface coatings. Okay, so as against the surface hardening processes, whatever the different types of processes that we have discussed. Nowadays, if you go to different industries, different engineering components, they are subjected to different kinds of surface coating coatings. Okay. Now, why surface coats are required? Because surface properties are most vital for engineering component. They decide not only the performance, but also the life of the components. Some of the surface properties that are vital: hardness, surface corrosion resistance, heat resistance, etc. And various surface coatings have been developed to address these three issues. Okay. Now, what are the important types of surface coating? We have phosphatizing, graphite coating, thin plating, hard anodizing, screen printing, and zinc plating. So, I will not go through the whole set of slides that I've shared, but I will just go through some of the important slides of each of these processes. Maybe I'll give 2 minutes each for each of these processes. Okay. So this is a kind of a layout of a surface coating plant. This is basically a shot taken from an industry in Kolhapur, Menon Pistons, where the pistons made by Menon Pistons, they are made to undergo different types of surface coating processes depending upon the requirement of the industry. So different industries which orders pistons from Menon Pistons, they have got different property requirements, and therefore they order different types of surface coatings. So coming to phosphatizing, you can see subsequent to phosphatizing, how this particular surface gets discolored, or rather the color changes. Okay, this is an indication that the component has been subjected to phosphatizing. Okay, phosphate coating is used on aluminium, steel, zinc, cadmium, silver, and tin parts for improving the corrosion resistance, lubricity, and as a foundation for subsequent coatings or paintings. Okay, so these are the applications for phosphatizing. Okay, and there are three types of phosphate coating: manganese, iron, and zinc. Okay, so we have manganese phosphate, iron phosphate, and zinc phosphate, which are used as base material, and immersing the component in these base materials, the coating takes place. So I'll not go through the whole process that has been mentioned here, but I will share the applications. Okay, so phosphating is used for corrosion protection in conjunction with organic coatings such as paints and polymers, facilitation of cold forming processes such as wire drawing, tube drawing, and deep drawing, corrosion protection in conjunction with oils and waxes, corrosion protection with no subsequent treatment, improving anti-friction properties such as break-in wear resistance, anti-galling, and coefficient of friction, providing strong adhesion bonding, etc. So, like phosphatizing, we also have graphite coating for withstanding high temperatures, providing better corrosion resistance, etc. Okay, heat and wear resistance. These are the applications of graphite coating. Okay, which can be applied by spray, brush, or by screen printing. Okay, it is used for cylinder castings, pistons of lightweight metals, for example, aluminium. Okay, the coating is usually galvanized and made from iron, nickel, and chromium, where galvanized layers are drawbacks as they are damaging the environment. You can say they're not environmental friendly. Okay, so mainly used for coating of pistons. Okay, these are some of the slides. And coming to the next type of surface coating, that is tin plating. Okay, it's the most cost effective process, mainly used for protection against corrosion. Okay, it produces a white grayish layer and dull matte appearance. Okay, when it is preferred. Okay, used in food industry. Okay, because it is FDA approved. Layer thickness is 50 microns for ferrous alloys and 50 to 20 microns for non-ferrous alloys. Okay, as I said, applications in aerospace, food industry, electronics, telecommunication, and jewelry manufacturing industries. These are the basic types of tin plating: barrel, rack, and vibratory. This is where I mentioned how these processes are used. The process by itself consists of 4 steps: cleaning, preparing the plating bath, the electro deposition procedure, and post electroplating process. Okay, all these I have mentioned in details. Okay, then coming to hard anodizing, It produces a hard wear resistant and abrasive resistance coating of aluminium oxide on aluminium alloys. It is an electrochemical oxidation process of aluminium surface. It leads to production of aluminium oxide. So aluminium is basically rusted artificially in hard anodizing. Okay. The properties that are enhanced are high abrasive resistance, corrosion resistance, thermal resistance, electrical resistance, and it also leaves some amount of porosity for coloring and sealing of the components. These are the steps. Okay, all the steps I mentioned, some 10 steps are there. Advantages of anodizing: it is highly durable, it is inexpensive, won't chip, flake or peel or chalk, maintains metallic appearance of aluminium, it is environment friendly. Okay, and coming to screen printing with molybdenum disulfide, okay, it is a solid film lubricant. Basically, it is used as a lubricant, okay, but also it's a protective coating which is used for different engineering components. Okay, with a graphite like feel and attributes, it is the most preferred dry lubricant for its robustness and low friction properties. Applications are how it is applied is vacuum applications and other types that are mentioned here. Okay, and the properties that are enhanced, again I mentioned here, coating methods, and these are the applications of molybdenum disulfide. Okay, coming to zinc plating, lastly, it is basically corrosion protection of steel parts. It is basically provides a cathodic protection. Okay, the layer produced protects the steel from further corrosion by cathodic protection. Okay, so the process I have mentioned here. Okay, and steps, the features, methods, and summary at the end. Okay, so can please go through. And lastly, in the last 5 minutes, I will just go through tools that are used for robots. Now that I have already discussed with you different types of engineering materials, how these engineering materials are important, useful, and how they are processed, you can understand by revisiting my earlier slides. Okay, so robots are built by using different common materials, like for example steels, cast irons, and aluminium. Okay, these are used mainly for arms and bases of robots. Some specialized robots for clean room applications, etc., they can use titanium material as the structural component, or even carbon fibers. Operating environment and strength required is a major factor in selection of the materials. And if our robot is mobile, for gripping purposes, we also use rubber as tires. Okay, so I will directly go to the different materials. So as I mentioned, steels, aluminium alloys, rubber and plastic, Kevlar, and smart materials are some of the important materials that you look required to look into while making robots. Okay, so steels, because of high strength, as I already mentioned, they can be heat treated, they can be made to possess ultra wear resistant resistance, which is one of the major property requirements as far as robots are concerned, and they can be subjected to welding for making the robot. That's why steels are used. Okay, so substitutes for steels, which materials can be used as a substitute for steels. So I've listed down different types of non-ferrous alloys as well as ferrous alloys. And when it came to ferrous alloys, earlier this was the material that was used, 1018 steel, and you can compare the strength to weight ratio of the plain carbon 1018 steel containing 0.18% average carbon. The strength to weight ratio was 216. So you can imagine how much of cross section or weight we had to use when it came to steel, plain carbon steels. So an advancement as far as ferrous alloys is concerned is instead of using 4018, use of 4130 steel, and you can see almost three times increase in the strength to weight ratio. And a modern Airmet 100 steel, which is an alloy of iron, cobalt, nickel, chromium, and molybdenum, has almost four times the strength So weight can be reduced as much as 1/4 of whatever the earlier steel, okay, 1018 steel. And in comparison with steels, we also have certain non-ferrous alloys. We can see that strength to weight ratio, and then wherever it is possible, we substitute steels with these non-ferrous alloys because there is a substantial weight reduction. Okay, so rubber, I have listed down what are the different types of rubbers that are used, okay, and what are the important properties that these rubbers possess for their applications in robots, okay. The manufacturing processes that are used for making these rubber components, soft lithography, roll-to-roll processing, 3D printing, etc., and the applications. Okay, so applications of rubber: human motor assistant, robotics, pneumatically powered humanoids, orthoses, prosthetics, etc., field robots, research missions, etc. And then coming to aluminium, once again, why aluminium is used? Kevlar, what is Kevlar, how it is processed, how it is manufactured, its applications in robots that I have listed down, okay, advantages and disadvantages of Kevlar as a material, okay. Apart from its use in robotics, what are the, so robotics I have mentioned here lastly, but these are the other applications of Kevlar. And coming to smart materials, which have now come become an important part and parcel of robotics. The reason as to why smart materials are used, I have mentioned here, that sensing materials, that actuating materials, they are control devices. They can be used as used for self-detection, self-diagnostics, self-corrective actions, self-controlled, self-healing. They are having shock absorbing properties and damage arrest. Okay. So the classification of smart materials: piezoelectric, electrostrictive, magnetostrictive, rheologic, rheological materials, thermoresponsive, electrochromic, tolerances, biometric, biomimetric, and smart gels. So these are the different types of smart materials. Okay. And lastly, I have mentioned in short one type of smart materials called as shape memory alloys, initially developed in silver cadmium alloys, now also a part and parcel of nickel titanium alloys, even some ferrous alloys, wherein the main technology or main you can say principle because of which SMAs regain their memories because of phase transformation. So initially you shape the alloy or the component by hardening it and forming martensite. You can deform this particular component, okay, and after deforming, if you reheat in the austenitic zone, okay, then the material will regain its original shape. It will remember its original shape, and then you can quench and reproduce this martensite, okay. So the whole details I mentioned here, and the applications of SMAs, aircrafts, dental braces, robotics, etc., etc. So with this, I end my presentation. Thank you very much for giving me this particular opportunities. I don't know whether we have overshot the time of 2:30 p.m. So
if no, sir, it's fine, sir. Yeah. So we'll open the session for any questions.
Please.
If any participant have any questions, I request them to kindly unmute and ask the questions. Or you can even put it in chat. If anybody has any questions.
Well, I only apologize to all the participants because the topic that was given to me was so vast. Okay, this in itself, advanced engineering materials can itself become an FDP, and advanced manufacturing processes can itself become a FDP. But as a part and parcel of this particular FDP, wherein robots are basically they require different types of engineering materials. So I was asked to make a presentation as to what are the advancements as far as materials are concerned, and what are the various advancements as far as manufacturing processes are concerned. So I have not been able to fully cover all the advances as far as materials are concerned, as well as manufacturing processes are concerned. But I have taken some important materials and important manufacturing processes to make you understand what are the future trends and how these materials can be used in robots. That is a submission from my side. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So I don't see any questions in the chat.
Okay. But if there are any other questions, subsequently, you can pass it on to me.
Yes, yes, definitely. Okay. Thank you, sir. So I would like to thank Professor S.S. Mane, sir, for his wonderful presentation. And with this, we come to an end of this particular session. So I thank all the participants as well as sir. And we would meet again at 3 p.m. for the last session of the FTP. Thank you all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.